A majority of adults over age 50 wish to stay in their homes and communities as they age, while just 25% plan to relocate. Today on Aging Wisely, we're talking about aging in place and how to prepare your home for the golden years. Welcome to Aging Wisely. I'm Bibi Rentella. The ability to age in place and stay in your home as long as possible requires pre-planning. We're going to cover the physical changes your home might need, along with how nutrition, friendships, and social activities play a role. Let's get a better idea of the types of remodeling projects that are common to age in place at a home in Faircrest.
Hi,
good
Bob.
Morning.
I'm Mark with Rebuilding
Mark.
Together, South Sound.
Bob Reiler, good to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Good to have you.
Just
here.
Noticing here, you got a beautiful sidewalk coming up here, a nice ramp made out of it.
Yeah, this is the first thing that we did when we moved into the house. We used to have three steps that came up here and a very small little porch. And so we replaced it with a ramp and a little larger area here.
Well, this is good. You just want to keep maintaining it. It was down on a good sand base, and that these don't move over the years.
You bet.
So you just want to keep an eye out for that. The other thing I noticed, you don't have a screen door, which is also good. That way you don't have to get through two doors when you're trying to get in.
Ah, okay.
So
don't put that up.
Disadvantage, though, is having all these rugs here.
Okay.
It's going to be a tripping hazard. Someone can very easily trip over these because there's several different heights of things here.
Okay.
So I did notice your door handle could be a little bit difficult for someone to, if they have mobility issues in their hands,
sure.
It might be hard for them to do the thumb on there.
Ah, okay.
So a lever handle, would be much more desirable for something on that.
Good. And this threshold here?
Yep, the threshold, the outside's really good. The inside is just a fraction high for what they would consider wheelchair access. You really don't want more than a quarter inch high. But with the way your house is built and the rugs in there, you really couldn't do much more with this one.
All right. Well, that's all very helpful. Hey, let's go take a look at the hall bathroom.
Right.
Now, Mark, I invited you over here to kind of give us an idea of how we can best work with this house to make it possible to age in place.
Okay.
So what are the things that we could be doing over the years ahead to kind of work on that? So here's the hall bathroom that I wanted you to look at. And I know it's a little small, but it's probably typical of what you see most of the time.
Yep, this would be hard to get a wheelchair in for the width of this bathroom. Typically, you need a 5-foot turning circle for that.
Mm-hmm.
It is good. You do have a comfort height toilet, or a chair height, as some people would call it.
Mm-hmm.
Your grab bars in there are very good.
We have grab bars.
Yep, that's good for getting in and out. You have a seat in there for sitting on, so someone's not going to get tired and fall down.
Mm-hmm.
You do have a shower wand that someone can bring down and shower with. A small tripping hazard with the rugs.
Yeah, okay. The rugs are an issue. And, and obviously, you know, we've debated about whether they have this tub modified at all. Could that be something that you'd want us to
There's a couple options. You could make a zero clearance shower to
Which
go
means
in there.
What's a zero
clearance? Zero clearance means that your floor height and the shower height are exactly the same.
Oh, okay.
So you could roll in with a wheelchair, or if your legs can't be picked up, you can just walk right in.
Mm-hmm.
They also make a step unit. You could cut out the tub and put in there to just lift your legs up slightly to get in.
Okay, just maybe a lip of a couple inches perhaps or something like that. Yeah, okay.
Yes, your handles on here are very good. The handles are easier for someone to grab than a single knob at the top.
They work pretty well. I think it takes a while for the water to get hot, but eventually
it does. Well for.
But what about, you mentioned the wheelchair. There's not a whole lot of room here to move around.
There's not a lot of room.
What about the door?
Short on the door here is only 28 inches wide.
28-inch door.
Typically for a walker or a wheelchair, you're going to want about 32 inches or more.
Ooh, okay.
So you have very little room. You could widen this door up slightly. They make hinges where the door will swing all the way out of the way. You could change the hinges. That would give you about another inch and a half of room.
All right.
So your clearance on the floor here is great. It's all hardscape floor.
Okay.
Easy to walk across, all the same height.
Okay, well, Mark, here's the master bathroom. It has a couple of issues that I know you're going to find.
Well, I noticed right off your shower door here, with this opening and swinging inside, someone were to fall, they would never be able to get anybody in there to get them out.
That's right, okay.
So I wouldn't do that. Grab bar is good. You shouldn't put a washcloth on there, though.
Okay.
So this one here, if someone were to get out of the shower and grab this, they're going to fall right down on the ground. I would put a grab bar, towel bar combination unit here. That way you could use it for both.
Okay, before I let you go, what about the what's the alternative to this door?
I would put a shower curtain in.
Shower curtain?
Yes.
Okay, easy enough to do that.
Yep.
All right.
In your toilet area here, water closet is nice, but with a pocket door there, it limits your access for wheelchair or a walker.
Sure.
I would take that back to the cabinet, take this door out, open a wall, you could put a cupboard. Comfort height toilet and grab bars are good also in there.
Okay.
The height of your counter right now is good for you right now, but later on, if you ever were in a wheelchair or somebody, it would be difficult for them to use it at that height.
Okay, good points. All right, well, let's go take a look at the kitchen now. Okay, Mark, here's the kitchen. And it's got...
I noticed right off your refrigerator and the counter are too close together here.
Really?
Yeah, you only have 27 inches, and if you open the door, you're going to be down to 15 inches.
Okay.
I'm not that skinny.
Yeah, well, neither am I.
So you're not going to be able to have very good access for a wheelchair. This is a little bit high. If you were in a wheelchair, you wouldn't be able to reach up to it.
Okay.
At the same point, your dishwasher is a little low for wheelchair access. The oven's good down here.
Okay.
So
that'll work okay.
Your knobs at the front of the stove is good. It's easy access for someone. I do notice that you have knobs here. There again, that's a little difficult to use if you have hand problems.
Well, the knobs work fine for us.
They're good, but your handles are much better. It's easier for someone that has arthritis or something to be able to stick their hand through there and grab those.
Yeah, okay.
Your access to this sink is going to be a little bit tough with the cupboards there. They do make where you can raise and lower them. They make open underneath. All sorts of options on that you can do.
Okay. Oh, and of course, I got my little puppy here. This is Oliver.
Oh, yeah, they're great companions to have. Only problem you do have to be careful of is they can be a tripping hazard for you, whether they're a dog or a cat.
Unconditional love, but not all that safe.
Unconditional love, but not that safe sometimes.
Okay. Well, Mark, thank you very much. Appreciate
Absolutely.
Your time.
All nice right. to see you, Bob. Bye.
Don't let all this information about remodeling overwhelm you. We are here to help you sort through all of the details. Joining us are two professionals who specialize in aging in place. Please welcome Rachel Lair and Trudy Bocott. Welcome.
Hello. Thank you.
What does aging in place mean to you?
It means planning. You have to plan for your future, whether it be financially, emotionally. You need to create a comprehensive plan for yourself, whether you hire an advisor or do it yourself, but you need to know what's coming.
Would you like to add? Yeah, I think it's also considering the investment that you've made in your home and your community, how you can stay there safely, independently, and as long as you want. And that can look like a lot of different things, a lot of what Trudy just said.
Mm-hmm. So when should someone start the planning process of aging in place?
I think you should start as soon as you find a job that you're comfortable in and that you know that you're going to stay there for a while, because every year inflation hits all of us. You need to remember that if you own a house in your future, do you plan on staying there? If you do, then you have to pay attention to replacement costs. Someday your furnace is going to go out, your refrigerator is going to go out, your washer and dryer. You need to remember those things and plan for those ahead.
Yeah, definitely probably sooner than most of us would like. If you're a person with any sort of chronic health condition, then understanding the progression of that disease over time is really helpful so that you know what to think about. If you have any sort of long-term health conditions, and then just remembering that as we age, our bodies don't do what we expect them to do anymore, and we have to think about what's
prepared.
Next. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You need to stay active. Very, very, very important.
Stay active.
Mm-hmm. Both physically and emotionally, because they affect one another.
Yes, agreed. Tips on that. What is needed in aging in place?
I feel the biggest thing that's needed is your financial plan. if you don't have a financial plan, you're not going to be saving for the right things. What are your goals in life? What do you want? When do you want to retire? Will you have enough money to retire? Will you have a retirement savings? Are you just going to be on your Social Security? There's a lot of questions for everybody, and everybody's a little different.
For sure.
Yeah. One of the biggest things to think about with aging in place is what place will you age in? Is it the home that you're currently living in? Is it the neighborhood that you're currently in? Maybe is it a space that's not going to work for you long term, or maybe you live far away from doctors and family and different points of connection in the community. So that would be kind of one of the biggest areas to think about. What do I need as I age?
So Trudy, the ability to stay home can be best accomplished when you have a team of people to help you. Mm-hmm. And who are these people that can be involved and can be part of the team?
I think there's a lot of people that can help you along the way. Your neighbors, for one. I would say, seriously, get to know your neighbors, because when you hit that point that you can't physically take care of yourself, you're going to need help. I would say your church, members of your church, get to know them. Go and volunteer for your church so that you have that nucleus of people that care for you. That's very, very important. Your family, too, of course. Oftentimes, I've seen this a lot with our Puyallup Activity Center. Parents will come up from different places. We just had one that transferred from the mom and dad lived in Maine, and their only child was here in Bellevue. So they sold everything they had to come to Bellevue because they only have one grandchild. That can be good. That can be bad.
Yeah.
Sometimes the children want the parents to babysit all the time. That's not good, obviously. Or they want them to live with them. Again, that could be good and that could be bad. Sometimes the grandparents think, why did I come this far? Why did I give it all up? Because now maybe their grandchildren are in school all day. What do they do? Mm-hmm. What do they do? They need to find a purpose.
That's a good one, yeah. But let's talk about home.
Yeah.
So what is in the house, what is the most important rooms when it comes to aging in place?
Yeah. I feel like the room that people most quickly bump into problems is the bathroom, because it's usually a small room.
Right.
It's the room where you're not really doing like the normal activities that you'd be doing anywhere else in your house. And it has some interesting barriers. Getting in and out of a tub can be a challenge for anybody with mobility issues.
Really, safety concerns.
Yeah, safety concerns. Yeah. It's the primary place that a person can slip and fall, really regardless of age. I had knee surgery in high school, and I had a hard time getting in and out of the tub to take a shower. And then that is harder when you have compounding medical problems. Even things as simple as getting on and off the toilet, just like getting in and out of a chair. If your body mechanics aren't working the way that they used to, if you have to push yourself off or pull yourself off to stand up, that can be a little bit hard without some different assistive things. The other places maybe will vary based on the type of condition that a person is dealing with or the way that their body is working. But the next biggest area I would say would be access to the home. So are there stairs from where you park your car into your house? Are the main or the primary living spaces of the home all on the main level? So do you have a bedroom, a full bathroom, and a kitchen on the main level of your home? And is there some sort of secondary exit that you can safely use if you have to use a wheelchair or a walker to get out? After that, things like doorways can be problematic if they're not big enough to fit a wheelchair or a walker through. Kitchens can get tricky because it's hard to get up close to a cabinet if you're in a wheelchair or reach to operate the dials for your stove, all the way down to any place that you have a door knob or like a knob for a bathroom faucet. That can be tricky if you have arthritis in your hands, so swapping knobs to levers or are places where people run into problems.
And even putting in safety rails would be a great thing too, because we don't think about that.
Yep.
A lot of our seniors that have homes, sometimes they have stairs. Very, very, very dangerous. I can't tell you how many have broken their ankles, even sliding down on their rear to make it a little bit safer. They still have tripped once they got to the bottom of the stairs. And I've also found that many of them have cordoned off their they're upstairs, mm-hmm. where they only stay downstairs.
Yep.
Speaking of which, so what kind of remodels that can be a good decision and what are to avoid?
Yeah. Again, that's going to depend a little bit on a person's condition and starting in those access places. So can you get around your bathroom safely and easily? Maybe considering switching a bathroom that has a tub to a bathroom with a shower, because that's going to be more accessible for more people. Thinking about if there's stairs and you could put a ramp in, or making sure that all of your doors are at least 36 inches wide so that you can get a wheelchair or walker in and out. You do have to kind of take into consideration what your physical needs are, but then also what are you starting with? If you have a split level home, it's going to be a lot harder to remodel that to make it friendly to age in place in over a home that's a single story or has, like I said before, the bedroom, the bathroom, and the kitchen all on one level. But there's ways to think through over time things that you can add in or modify. So if you're doing a bathroom remodel and you're in your 40s, you're not thinking about long-term yet, or you don't want to put the shower in where there's a tub, you could put blocking behind the walls where, next to the toilet or in the shower, and that will help as bracing for grab bars in the future so that wherever you need that, you can just screw right in and it's safe and it'll carry load. Even things as simple as swapping doorknobs for levers or putting rocker-style light switches in instead of the actual switch, because those are easier for you to brush down to turn on and off than the little lever.
Great information. Mm-hmm. Tell me about CAP specialists and how can they help and design changes in homes?
So a CAPS is a certification that is a 3-day long course that's put on by the National Association of Home Builders.
What does it stand for?
Yeah, CAP stands for a Certified Aging in Place Specialist. So that course helps primarily builders and designers think through ways to make modifications to the home environment to make it safer for a person over the course of time. There's been a lot of interest as well by occupational therapists and physical therapists mm-hmm. as they're working with clients and they want to learn the lingo and the layouts and things that are positive or positive switches in a home. So it's an interesting course. It's one that I've been through and helps gain familiarity with different products and materials and ways to lay out a space to help it be friendly to more people for more time.
Great information too. So Trudy, so I want to ask you, why is social connectedness very important in people in aging?
I think it has to do with kind of the reason you get up in the morning. Everybody needs a reason to get up in the morning and they need to stay social. That's what keeps them active. That's what keeps them mentally fit, physically fit. You have to have that every morning. I can't tell you how many times I've seen my seniors have come to me and said, Trude, geez, I just have nothing to do. Well, then get out and volunteer. You need to stay active. You seriously do. You need a reason to get up in the morning, get dressed, go somewhere. And again, join a church. If you don't have a church, join a church. They can be so much help to individuals who might be a little shy, don't feel like they have the maybe the energy to get out there and do things on their own. So churches can help kind of keep you in that little hub there.
Are there other things to consider when it comes to neighborhood and maybe transportation-wise? How can we help?
You need to think always, because it's going to happen to everybody. What's going to happen when you don't drive anymore, mm-hmm. whether that be voluntary or involuntary? What are you going to do? Mm-hmm. Who's going to get you to the doctor's appointments? Who's going to get you to the grocery store? Mm-hmm. Who's going to take you out to lunch? Mm-hmm. You can't always depend on your family for that, because sometimes they might feel overwhelmed, mm-hmm. and maybe the first two times is okay, but then the next time, what if you have to go to the doctor a lot? Well, mm-hmm. they don't want to take you anymore. I always try to tell everybody, if possible, obviously it isn't always, but if possible, when you retire, try to get in a situation, a neighborhood where you're close to a doctor that you can mm-hmm. walk to, be close to a grocery store. Downtown Puyallup is a great example because they have doctors right downtown. They have the grocery store, Safeway, mm-hmm. right there they can walk to. They're on the hub for the bus line. They can mm-hmm. go to the mall. We have tons of restaurants downtown Puyallup that they can walk to. It's very, very important to keep that in mind. You can't always drive.
Mm-hmm. That's true. Mm-hmm. Would yeah. you like to add anything on that?
Yeah, those are all really great points. One thing to think about is if your neighborhood has sidewalks, because it's not always super safe to walk in the street because there's people parked on the side of the street, people aren't always paying attention. So does your neighborhood have sidewalks, and then does it have those special curb cuts with the yellow rectangles with the bumps on it? That helps both people who have vision problems safely enter streets and crosswalks, as well as folks who are using any sort of wheelchair or walker, or even a mom with a stroller. You don't have to bump up and down on those curbs anymore.
Advanced planning is great. And so, but there's some things that we can't anticipate. So what right. are some things that makes it hard to age in place?
If you fall, a great example. Okay, so you think you're physically fit, and a lot of seniors are, but there's always that, I just had one fall off a curb, and mm-hmm. she shattered her ankle. She mm-hmm. didn't anticipate that. She's still, she's young, she's in her 60s, but now what is she going to do? Now she has to rely on something she never had to before. She can't do her own transportation. She can't drive now. How is she going to get around? How is she going to get to those doctor's appointments? Mm-hmm. And she specifically relied on friends, not family so much, but friends. So the unexpected, it can happen to any of us whatsoever.
That's pretty true. Mm-hmm. So what do you think are the great benefits in aging in place?
One of them is that, like I said before, that your memories and your investment in a community is honored. People tend to do better long-term, especially if they have any sort of memory issue, if they're in the home that they've known for a long period of time. And you know your neighbors, you know the secret way to go to the grocery store when this other way is busy. You have the relationships that you've developed with folks at church and your doctor's office, your friends in the neighborhood, all of that. And I think it really overall helps the stability of our neighborhood. It helps our neighborhoods be intergenerational so that it's not just a rental neighborhood. It's not just a neighborhood with families with young kids. There's a lot of different people in the community, and it helps to strengthen our communities that way.
Would you like to add?
Mm-hmm. I agree with that completely. And again, it's all about being active, whether it be physical, mental. Go to the Y. If you can't afford a Y, go to a senior center. They always have weight rooms. We have a great weight room, and it's all for free. We don't charge any annual membership. They can come in. We have tons of wellness programs. Most senior centers do. We have exercise classes 5 days a week. We have dance classes. We have Zumba. We have salsa dancing, mm-hmm. belly dancing. Yes, yoga, tai chi. Get involved
Sounds
in those.
Sounds like fun.
It is fun. It is fun. That's why they come there. We have about 200 a day. So it's a great place to be. And we're like a big family. Everybody loves each other. We care about each other. If somebody doesn't show up for a couple days, we're on that phone calling. Where are you? Are you okay? And that's what it's about. Yeah, being active.
Being active is mm-hmm. what that is the most important.
Very important.
What can we do if we can't afford the costs and the changes in the home?
Yeah, that's a great question. There's an array of different community resources that are available to folks. I work for one of them. I work for Rebuilding Together South Sound.
Give us a little information
about
that.
Yeah, we're a housing nonprofit located here in Tacoma, connected to a network of Rebuilding Together affiliates across the country. And we really focus on a safe home and community for every person. Our work primarily focuses on providing home repairs and modifications for seniors, folks with disabilities, and families with children. And so we have a lot of people come to us who are getting ready for knee surgery and need a ramp, or can't use their bathtub anymore and really need a shower, or even just something as simple as, I can't get on and off the toilet anymore. So a taller toilet called a Comfort Height toilet and a couple grab bars in their bathroom make the difference. and for an investment of maybe $300, we can reduce their risk of falls, and that could be a savings of their life. It could be a savings of $60,000 for a hip replacement, things like that. So so Rebuilding Together South Sound provides a lot of those services for folks in need. There's also a lot of opportunities through local government. So Pierce County has some home repair programs, as well as some weatherization programs, and the health department has a program to replace wood stoves, either with some sort of electric heat source or a cleaner burning pellet stove. The city of Tacoma also has similar programs, and there's a handful of other municipalities who have their own targeted money, and a couple other different community programs that can support folks. Paint Tacoma Beautiful will paint the exterior of homes. Metropolitan Development Council has some funds to help people pay their energy bills, as well as a lot of the major power providers in the area. There's also some different agencies that have the ability to upgrade heating systems so that you're using something more efficient than what you have now. So there is really a lot out there for different folks. And we help people all the time try to find that one little thing that they need. And there's a couple different places that you can contact in the area if you are curious about those resources.
How can they reach you?
Rebuilding Together South Sound, you can call us at 253-238-0977 or our website, rebuildingtogethersS.org. And I'm sure information will pop up later. We have some folks who will take you through a couple basic screening questions. And like I said, we know a lot of the resources, so maybe you don't fit into the folks that we serve, but you're not quite sure where to go, and we can try to help you do that as well.
Great tips. Golden years is said to be the best years of your life. How can one be prepared at home during their golden years?
Several years ago, I wrote an article for the TNT about the so-called golden years. And what I have found over the years, and I've been doing this for 25 years, I don't think there really are any golden years, because unfortunately, by the time that you retire, and people are living longer nowadays, they're working longer. They're not retiring at 62 anymore or 65. They're going to 70, 75. Obviously, your health is going to decline during those years. Many, many people find that they haven't saved enough money. They didn't start early enough. That's a big problem right there. How do you want to, when you retire, live within your means? What do you actually need? Big difference, what you want, what do you need? Obviously, your Social Security, once you hit 70, isn't going to get any higher. It's going to stay the same. Your retirement, if you're lucky enough to have a retirement, that's going to stay the same once you retire. You've got to figure all those in for when you mentally and physically are able to retire. So not so much, I've never felt that many people, put it this way, not many people fit into that golden years, that they're happy, they're physically fit, they have the money, they can travel. Again, even if you have some money, you need to stretch that out, because you're going to live longer nowadays.
Thank you for being here today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm Bibi Rantella. Thank you for watching Aging Wisely. We'll leave you now with a list of resources to learn more about aging in place.